Chapter 1, Observing the Armies on the Battlefield of Kurukṣetra. Text 1. Dhritarashtra huvacha dharmakshetre kurukshetre samaveta yuyutsavaha mamaka pandavaschaiva kimako vata sanjaya. Dhritarashtra said, O Sanjaya, after my sons and the sons of Pandu assembled in the place of pilgrimage at Kurukṣetra, desiring to fight, what did they do? Purport. Bhagavad Gita is the widely read theistic science summarized in the Gita Mahatmya, the glorification of the Gita. There it says that one should read Bhagavad Gita very scrutinizingly with the help of a person who is a devotee of Sri Krishna, and try to understand it without personally motivated interpretations. The example of clear understanding is there in the Bhagavad Gita itself, in the way the teaching is understood by Arjuna, who heard the Gita directly from the Lord. If someone is fortunate enough to understand Bhagavad Gita in that line of disciplic succession, without motivated interpretation, then he surpasses all studies of Vedic wisdom and all scriptures of the world. One will find in the Bhagavad Gita all that is contained in other scriptures, but the reader will also find things which are not to be found elsewhere. That is the specific standard of the Gita. It is the perfect theistic science because it is directly spoken by the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Lord Sri Krishna. The topics discussed by Dhritarashtra and Sanjaya, as described in the Mahabharata, form the basic principle for this great philosophy. It is understood that this philosophy evolved on the battlefield of Kurukṣetra, which is a sacred place of pilgrimage from the immemorial time of the Vedic age. It was spoken by the Lord when he was present personally on this planet for the guidance of mankind. The word Dharmakshetra, a place where religious rituals are performed, is significant because on the battlefield of Kurukṣetra, the Supreme Personality of Godhead was present on the side of Arjuna. Dhritarashtra, the father of the Kurus, was highly doubtful about the possibility of his son's ultimate victory. In his doubt, he inquired from his secretary Sanjay, what did they do? He was confident that both his sons and the sons of his younger brother Pandu were assembled in that field of Kurukṣetra for a determined engagement of the war. Still, his inquiry is significant. He did not want a compromise between the cousins and brothers, and he wanted to be sure of the fate of his sons on the battlefield. Because the battle was arranged to be fought at Kurukṣetra, which is mentioned elsewhere in the Vedas as a place of worship, even for the denizens of heaven, Dhritarashtra became very fearful about the influence of the holy place on the outcome of the battle. He knew very well that this would influence Arjuna and the sons of Pandu favorably, because by nature they were all virtuous. Sanjay was a student of Vyas, and therefore, by the mercy of Vyas, Sanjay was able to envision the battlefield of Kurukṣetra even while he was in the room of Dhritarashtra. And so Dhritarashtra asked him about the situation on the battlefield. Both the Pandavas and the sons of Dhritarashtra belong to the same family, but Dhritarashtra's mind is disclosed herein. He deliberately claimed only his sons as Kurus, and he separated the sons of Pandu from the family heritage. One can thus understand the specific position of Dhritarashtra in his relationship with his nephews, the sons of Pandu. As in the paddy field the unnecessary plants are taken out, so it is expected from the very beginning of these topics that in the religious field of Kurukṣetra, where the father of religion, Sri Krishna, was present, the unwanted plants like Dhritarashtra's son Duryodhana and others would be wiped out, and the thoroughly religious persons headed by Yudhisthira would be established by the Lord. This is the significance of the words Dharmakshetre and Kurukṣetre, apart from their historical and Vedic importance. Text 2. Asanjayu vacha drishtva tu pandavanikam vyudhang duryodhanastada Achayam upasangamya raja vachanam amravit. Sanjaya said, O king, after looking over the army arranged in military formation by the sons of Pandu, King Duryodhana went to his teacher and spoke the following words. Purport. Dhritarashtra was blind from birth. Unfortunately, he was also bereft of spiritual vision. He knew very well that his sons were equally blind in the matter of religion, and he was sure that they could never reach an understanding with the Pandavas, who were all pious since birth. Still, he was doubtful about the influence of the place of pilgrimage, and Sanjaya could understand his motive in asking about the situation on the battlefield. Sanjaya wanted, therefore, to encourage the despondent king, and thus assured him that his sons were not going to make any sort of compromise under the influence of the holy place. Sanjaya therefore informed the king that his son, Duryodhana, after seeing the military force of the Pandavas, at once went to the commander-in-chief, Dronacharya, to inform him of the real position. Although Duryodhana is mentioned as the king, he still had to go to the commander on account of the seriousness of the situation. He was therefore quite fit to be a politician. But Duryodhana's diplomatic veneer could not disguise the fear he felt when he saw the military arrangement of the Pandavas. Text 3. Pashyaitang Panduputranam Achaya Mahatim Chamum Vyudham Drupadaputrena Tavashishena Dhimata. O my teacher, behold the great army of the sons of Pandu, so expertly arranged by your intelligent disciple, the son of Drupada. Purport. Duryodhana, a great diplomat, wanted to point out the defects of Dronacharya, the great Brahmin commander-in-chief. Dronacharya had some political quarrel with King Drupada, the father of Draupadi, who was Arjuna's wife. As a result of this quarrel, Drupada performed a great sacrifice, by which he received the benediction of having a son who would be able to kill Dronacharya. Dronacharya knew this perfectly well, and yet, as a liberal Brahmin, he did not hesitate to impart all his military secrets when the son of Drupada, Drishtadyumna, was entrusted to him for military education. Now, on the battlefield of Kurukṣetra, Drishtadyumna took the side of the Pandavas, and it was he who arranged for their military phalanx, after having learned the art from Dronacharya. Duryodhana pointed out this mistake of Dronacharya's so that he might be alert and uncompromising in the fighting. By this, he wanted to point out also that he should not be similarly lenient in battle against the Pandavas, who were also Dronacharya's affectionate students. Arjuna especially was his most affectionate and brilliant student. Duryodhana also warned that such leniency in the fight would lead to defeat. Text 4. Atrasura Maheshvasa Bhimarjana Samayudhi Yuyudhano Varatascha Dupadascha Maharataha. Here in this army are many heroic bowmen, equal in fighting to Bhima and Arjuna, great fighters like Yuyudhan, Virata, and Drupada. Purport. Even though Drishtadyumna was not a very important obstacle in the face of Dronacharya's very great power in the military art, there were many others who were causes of fear. They are mentioned by Duryodhana as great stumbling blocks on the path of victory, because each and every one of them was as formidable as Bhima and Arjuna. He knew the strength of Bhima and Arjuna, and thus he compared the others with them. Text 5. Drishtaketuschekitano Kasirajascha Viryavan Purjit Kundi Bhojascha Saibyascha Nadapungavaha. There are also great heroic powerful fighters like Drishtaketu, Chekitana, Kasiraj, Purujit, Kunti Bhoja, and Shaibya. Text 6. Yudhamanyuscha Vikranta Uttamaujascha Viryavan Saubhandro Draupadeyascha Sarva Eva Maharataho. There are the mighty Yudhamanyu, the very powerful Uttamauja, the son of Subhadra and the sons of Draupadi. All these warriors are great chariot fighters. Text 7. Asmakam tu visishtaye tannibodha vijotama nayaka mama sainyasya sanghyatam tanbravimite. But for your information, O best of the Brahmins, let me tell you about the captains who are especially qualified to lead my military force. Text 8. Bhavan bhishmascha karnascha kripascha samatinjayaha ashvathama vikarnascha samadattisthadhaivacha. There are personalities like you, Bhishma, Karna, Kripa, Ashvathama, Vikarna, and the son of Somadatta called Bhurishrava, who are always victorious in battle. Purport. Duryodhana mentions the exceptional heroes in the battle, all of whom are ever victorious. Vikarna is the brother of Duryodhana. Ashvathama is the son of Dronacharya. And Saumadatti, or Bhurishrava, is the son of the king of the Balikas. Karna is the half-brother of Arjuna, as he was born of Kunti before her marriage with King Pandu. Kripacharya's twin sister married Dronacharya. Text 9. Anye cha bahava sura marate chakcha jivita nana shastra paharana sarve yudha visharada. There are many other heroes who are prepared to lay down their lives for my sake. All of them are well equipped with different kinds of weapons, and all are experienced in military science. Purport. As far as the others are concerned, like Jayadratha, Kritavarma, and Shalya, all are determined to lay down their lives for Duryodhana's sake. In other words, it is already concluded that all of them would die in the battle of Kurukṣetra for joining the party of the sinful Duryodhana. Duryodhana was, of course, confident of his victory on account of the above-mentioned combined strength of his friends. Text 10. Aparyaktam tadasmakam balam bhishma birakshitam paryaktam vidamete sham balam bhima birakshitam. Our strength is immeasurable, and we are perfectly protected by Grandfather Bhishma, whereas the strength of the Pandavas, carefully protected by Bhima, is limited. Purport. Herein, an estimation of comparative strength is made by Duryodhana. He thinks that the strength of his armed forces is immeasurable, being specifically protected by the most experienced general, Grandfather Bhishma. On the other hand, the forces of the Pandavas are limited, being protected by a less experienced general, Bhima, who was like a fig in the presence of Bhishma. Duryodhana was always envious of Bhima because he knew perfectly well that if he should die at all, he would only be killed by Bhima. But at the same time, he was confident of his victory on account of the presence of Bhishma, who was a far superior general. His conclusion that he would come out of the battle victorious was well ascertained. Text 11. Ayaneshu cha sarveshu yata bhagam avastita bhishmam eva birakshantu bhavanta sarvehi. All of you must now give full support to Grandfather Bhishma as you stand at your respective strategic points of entrance into the phalanx of the army. Purport. Duryodhana, after praising the prowess of Bhishma, further considered that others might think that they had been considered less important, so in his usual diplomatic way, he tried to adjust the situation in the above words. He emphasized that Bhishmadeva was undoubtedly the greatest hero, but he was an old man, so everyone must especially think of his protection from all sides. He might become engaged in the fight, and the enemy might take advantage of his full engagement on one side. Therefore, it was important that other heroes not leave their strategic positions and allow the enemy to break the phalanx. Duryodhana clearly felt that the victory of the Kurus depended on the presence of Bhishmadeva. He was confident of the full support of Bhishmadeva and Dronacharya in the battle, because he well knew that they did not even speak a word when Arjuna's wife Draupadi, in her helpless condition, had appealed to them for justice while she was being forced to appear naked in the presence of the great generals in the assembly. Although he knew that the two generals had some sort of affection for the Pandavas, He hoped that these generals would now completely give it up, as they had done during the gambling performances. Text 12. Tasya sanjanayan harsham kuru vridha pitamaho singhanadam vinanyochai shankham dhanmo pitapavan. Then Bhishma, the great valiant grandsire of the Kuru dynasty, the grandfather of the fighters, blew his conch shell very loudly, making a sound like the roar of a lion, giving Duryodhana joy. Purport. The grandsire of the Kuru dynasty could understand the inner meaning of the heart of his grandson Duryodhana, and out of his natural compassion for him, he tried to cheer him by blowing his conch shell very loudly, befitting his position as a lion. Indirectly, by the symbolism of the conch shell, he informed his depressed grandson Duryodhana that he had no chance of victory in the battle, because the Supreme Lord Krishna was on the other side. But still, it was his duty to conduct the fight, and no pains would be spared in that connection. Text 13. Tatak shankascha bhiryascha panavanaka gomukha sahasaivabhyahanyanta sashabdastu malomhavat. After that, the conch shells, drums, bugles, trumpets, and horns were all suddenly sounded, and the combined sound was tumultuous. Text 14. Tatak shvetar haya yukti mahati syandane stito madavak pandavaschaiva divyo shankho padadmatu. On the other side, both Lord Krishna and Arjuna, stationed on a great chariot drawn by white horses, sounded their transcendental conch shells. Purport. In contrast with the conch shell blown by Bhishmadev, the conch shells in the hands of Krishna and Arjuna are described as transcendental. The sounding of the transcendental conch shells indicated that there was no hope of victory for the other side, because Krishna was on the side of the Pandavas. Jayastu Panduputranam Yesham Pakshe Janardana. Victory is always with persons like the sons of Pandu, because Lord Krishna is associated with them. And whenever and wherever the Lord is present, the goddess of fortune is also there, because the goddess of fortune never lives alone without her husband. Therefore, victory and fortune were awaiting Arjuna, as indicated by the transcendental sound produced by the conch shell of Vishnu, or Lord Krishna. Besides that, the chariot on which both the friends were seated had been donated by Agni, the fire god, to Arjuna, and this indicated that this chariot was capable of conquering all sides wherever it was drawn over the three worlds. Text 15. Panchajanyang Rishikesho Devadattang Dhananjayaha Pandrang Dadmo Mahasankham Bhimakarma Vrikodadaha. Lord Krishna blew his conch shell, called Panchajanya. Arjuna blew his, the Devadatta. And Bhima, the voracious eater and performer of Herculean tasks, blew his terrific conch shell, called Poundra. Purport. Lord Krishna is referred to as Rishikesh in this verse because he is the owner of all senses. The living entities are part and parcel of him, and therefore the senses of the living entities are also part and parcel of his senses. The impersonalists cannot account for the senses of the living entities, and therefore they are always anxious to describe all living entities as senseless or impersonal. The Lord, situated in the hearts of all living entities, directs their senses, but he directs in terms of the surrender of the living entity, and in the case of a pure devotee, he directly controls the senses. Here on the battlefield of Kurukṣetra, the Lord directly controls the transcendental senses of Arjuna, and thus his particular name of Rishikesh. The Lord has different names according to his different activities. For example, his name is Madhusudana because he killed the demon of the name Madhu. His name is Govinda because he gives pleasure to the cows and to the senses. His name is Vasudev because he appeared as the son of Vasudev. His name is Devaki Nandana because he accepted Devaki as his mother. His name is Yashoda Anandana because he awarded his childhood pastimes to Yashoda at Vrindavan. His name is Parthasarathi because he worked as charioteer of his friend Arjuna. Similarly, his name is Rishikesh because he gave direction to Arjuna on the battlefield of Kurukṣetra. Arjuna is referred to as Dhananjaya in this verse because he helped his elder brother in fetching wealth when it was required by the king to make expenditures for different sacrifices. Similarly, Bhima is known as Rikodara because he could eat as voraciously as he could perform Herculean tasks, such as killing the demon Hidimba. So the particular types of conch shell blown by the different personalities on the side of the Pandavas, beginning with the lords, were all very encouraging to the fighting soldiers. On the other side, there were no such credits, nor the presence of Lord Krishna, the Supreme Director, nor that of the Goddess of Fortune. So they were predestined to lose the battle, and that was the message announced by the sounds of the conch shells. Text 16-18. Ananda Vijayam Raja Kunti Putro Yudhishthirah Nakula Sahadevascha Sugosha Munipushpako Kashyascha Padameshvasa Shikandicha Maharata Drishcha Jumno Viratascha Satyakischa Parajitah Drupado Draupadeyascha Sarvasha Pritivipati Sabhadrascha Mahambahu Shankhandhanhu Patakpitak. King Yudhishthir, the son of Kunti, blew his conch shell, the Ananta Vijay, and Nakula and Sahadev blew the Sugosh and Manipushpaka. That great archer, the king of Kashi, the great fighter Shikhandi, Drishtajumna, Virata, the unconquerable Satyaki, Drupada, the sons of Draupadi, and others, O king, such as the mighty-armed son of Subhadra, all blew their respective conch shells. Purport. Sanjay informed King Dhritarashtra very tactfully that his unwise policy of deceiving the sons of Pandu and endeavoring to enthrone his own sons on the seat of the kingdom was not very laudable. The signs already clearly indicated that the whole Kuru dynasty would be killed in that great battle. Beginning with the grandsire, Bhishma, down to the grandsons like Abhimanyu and others, including kings from many states of the world, all were present there, and all were doomed. The whole catastrophe was due to King Dhritarashtra because he encouraged the policy followed by his sons. Text 19. Sagosho dhatarastranam vidyani vidariyat nabascha prativinchaiva tumalo bhinunadayan. The blowing of these different conch shells became uproarious, vibrating both in the sky and on the earth. It shattered the hearts of the sons of Dhritarashtra. Purport. When Bhishma and the others on the side of Duryodhana blew their respective conch shells, there was no heartbreaking on the part of the Pandavas. Such occurrences are not mentioned, but in this particular verse it is mentioned that the hearts of the sons of Dhritarashtra were shattered by the sounds vibrated by the Pandavas party. This is due to the Pandavas and their confidence in Lord Krishna. One who takes shelter of the Supreme Lord has nothing to fear, even in the midst of the greatest calamity. Text 20. Ata vivastitan drishtva dhartarastran kapidhvaja pravitti shastra sampati donorudhyam yapandavaha rishikesham tadavakyam idamaha mahipati. At that time, Arjuna, the son of Pandu, seated in the chariot bearing the flag marked with Hanuman, took up his bow and prepared to shoot his arrows. O king, after looking at the sons of Dhritarashtra drawn in military array, Arjuna then spoke to Lord Krishna these words. Purport. The battle was just about to begin. It is understood from the above statement that the sons of Dhritarashtra were more or less disheartened by the unexpected arrangement of military force by the Pandavas, who were guided by the direct instructions of Lord Krishna on the battlefield. The emblem of Hanuman on the flag of Arjuna is another sign of victory, because Hanuman cooperated with Lord Ram in the battle between Ram and Ravana, and Lord Ram emerged victorious. Now both Ram and Hanuman were present on the chariot of Arjuna to help him. Lord Krishna is Ram himself, and wherever Lord Ram is, his eternal servitor Hanuman, and his eternal consort Sita, the goddess of fortune, are present. Therefore, Arjuna had no cause to fear any enemies whatsoever. And above all, the Lord of the senses, Lord Krishna, was personally present to give him direction. Thus, all good counsel was available to Arjuna in the matter of executing the battle. In such auspicious conditions, arranged by the Lord for his eternal devotee, lay the signs of assured victory. Texts 21-22. Arjuna Vacha Sena yodubayo madhi ratang stapaya mechuta yavad etan nidikshehung yodhu kaman avastitan karmaya sahayodhavyam asmin ranasamudyame. Arjuna said, O infallible one, please draw my chariot between the two armies so that I may see those present here who desire to fight and with whom I must contend in this great trial of arms. Report. Although Lord Krishna is the Supreme Personality of Godhead, out of his causeless mercy he was engaged in the service of his friend. He never fails in his affection for his devotees, and thus he is addressed herein as infallible. As charioteer, he had to carry out the orders of Arjuna, and since he did not hesitate to do so, he is addressed as infallible. Although he had accepted the position of a charioteer for his devotee, his supreme position was not challenged. In all circumstances, he is the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Rishikesh, the Lord of the total senses. The relationship between the Lord and his servitor is very sweet and transcendental. The servitor is always ready to render service to the Lord, and similarly, the Lord is always seeking an opportunity to render some service to the devotee. He takes greater pleasure in his pure devotees assuming the advantageous position of ordering him than he does in being the giver of orders. Since he is master, everyone is under his orders, and no one is above him to order him. But when he finds that a pure devotee is ordering him, he obtains transcendental pleasure, although he is the infallible master of all circumstances. As a pure devotee of the Lord, Arjuna had no desire to fight with his cousins and brothers, but he was forced to come onto the battlefield by the obstinacy of Duryodhana, who was never agreeable to any peaceful negotiation. Therefore, he was very anxious to see who the leading persons present on the battlefield were. Although there was no question of a peacemaking endeavor on the battlefield, he wanted to see them again, and to see how much they were bent upon demanding an unwanted war. Text 23. Yotsyamanana vikshehum ya ete trasamagata dhartarastrasya durbudhir yudhe priyachikishavaha. Let me see those who have come here to fight, wishing to please the evil-minded son of Dhritarashtra. Purport. It was an open secret that Duryodhana wanted to usurp the kingdom of the Pandavas by evil plans, in collaboration with his father, Dhritarashtra. Therefore, all persons who had joined the side of Duryodhana must have been birds of the same feather. Arjuna wanted to see them on the battlefield before the fight was begun, just to learn who they were, but he had no intention of proposing peace negotiations with them. It was also a fact that he wanted to see them to make an estimate of the strength which he had to face, although he was quite confident of victory because Krishna was sitting by his side. Text 24. Sanjay uvacha eva mukto rishikesho gudakeshena bharata sena yodobayo madhye stapayitn varatottamam. Sanjaya said, O descendant of Bharat, having thus been addressed by Arjuna, Lord Krishna drew up the fine chariot in the midst of the armies of both parties. Purport. In this verse, Arjuna is referred to as Gudakesh. Gudaka means sleep, and one who conquers sleep is called Gudakesh. Sleep also means ignorance. So Arjuna conquered both sleep and ignorance because of his friendship with Krishna. As a great devotee of Krishna, he could not forget Krishna even for a moment, because that is the nature of a devotee. Either in waking or in sleep, a devotee of the Lord can never be free from thinking of Krishna's name, form, qualities, and pastimes. Thus, a devotee of Krishna can conquer both sleep and ignorance simply by thinking of Krishna constantly. This is called Krishna consciousness or samadhi. As Rishikesh, or the director of the senses and mind of every living entity, Krishna could understand Arjuna's purpose in placing the chariot in the midst of the armies. Thus he did so and spoke as follows. Text 25. Bhishma Drona Pramukata Sarve Shang Chamahik Chitam Uvacha Parta Pashyaitan Samavetan Kuru Niti. In the presence of Bhishma, Drona, and all the other chieftains of the world, the Lord said, "Just behold, Partha, all the Kurus assembled here." Purport. As the supersoul of all living entities, Lord Krishna could understand what was going on in the mind of Arjuna. The use of the word Rishikesh in this connection indicates that he knew everything. And the word Partha, or the son of Kunti or Prita, is also similarly significant in reference to Arjuna. As a friend, Krishna wanted to inform Arjuna that because Arjuna was the son of Prita, the sister of Krishna's own father, Vasudev, Krishna had agreed to be the charioteer of Arjuna. Now what did Krishna mean when he told Arjuna to behold the Kurus? Did Arjuna want to stop there and not fight? Krishna never expected such things from the son of his aunt, Prita. The mind of Arjuna was thus predicted by the Lord in friendly joking. Text 26. Tatra pashyat stitan parta pitrin ata pitamahan archayan matulan bratrin putran pautran sakin sata shashuran suridaschaiva senayodabayodapi. There Arjuna could see within the midst of the armies of both parties his fathers, grandfathers, teachers, maternal uncles, brothers, sons, grandsons, friends, and also his fathers-in-law and well-wishers. Purport. On the battlefield, Arjuna could see all kinds of relatives. He could see persons like Bhurishava, who were his father's contemporaries, grandfathers Bhishma and Somadatta, teachers like Dronacharya and Kripacharya, maternal uncles like Shalya and Shakuni, brothers like Duryodhana, sons like Lakshman, friends like Ashwatthama, well-wishers like Kritavarma, etc. He could see also the armies which contained many of his friends. Text 27. Tansa miksha sakanteha sarvan bandhun avastitan gripaya padaya vishto vishidhan nidam abravid. When the son of Kunti, Arjuna, saw all these different grades of friends and relatives, he became overwhelmed with compassion and spoke thus. Text 28. Arjuna huvacha drishtve mam sajanam krishna yuyutsum samapastitam sidanti mama gatrani mukam cha parishushyati. Arjuna said, "My dear Krishna, seeing my friends and relatives present before me in such a fighting spirit, I feel the limbs of my body quivering and my mouth drying up." Purport. Any man who has genuine devotion to the Lord has all the good qualities which are found in godly persons or in the demigods, whereas the non-devotee, however advanced he may be in material qualifications by education and culture, lacks in godly qualities. As such, Arjuna, just after seeing his kinsmen, friends, and relatives on the battlefield, was at once overwhelmed by compassion for them who had so decided to fight amongst themselves. As far as his soldiers were concerned, he was sympathetic from the beginning, but he felt compassion even for the soldiers of the opposite party, foreseeing their imminent death. And while he was so thinking, the limbs of his body began to quiver, and his mouth became dry. He was more or less astonished to see their fighting spirit. Practically the whole community, all blood relatives of Arjuna, had come to fight with him. This overwhelmed a kind devotee like Arjuna. Although it is not mentioned here, still one can easily imagine that not only were Arjuna's bodily limbs quivering and his mouth drying up, but he was also crying out of compassion. Such symptoms in Arjuna were not due to weakness, but to his soft-heartedness, a characteristic of a pure devotee of the Lord. It is said, therefore, Yasyasti bhakti bhagavatya kinchana Sarvayagunais tatta samasati sura Harava bhaktasya kuto mahadguna Manodatena satidhavato bahi. One who has unflinching devotion for the personality of Godhead has all the good qualities of the demigods. But one who is not a devotee of the Lord has only material qualifications that are of little value. This is because he is hovering on the mental plane and is certain to be attracted by the glaring material energy. Srimad Bhagavatam 5.18.12. Text 29. Vepatuscha sharire me romaharshascha jayati gandhivang srangshati hastat tvakchaiva paridahyati. My whole body is trembling, my hair is standing on end, my bow, Gandiva, is slipping from my hand, and my skin is burning. Purport. There are two kinds of trembling of the body and two kinds of standings of the hair on end. Such phenomena occur either in great spiritual ecstasy or out of great fear under material conditions. There is no fear in transcendental realization. Arjuna's symptoms in this situation are out of material fear, namely loss of life. This is evident from other symptoms also. He became so impatient that his famous bow Gandiva was slipping from his hands, and because his heart was burning within him, he was feeling a burning sensation of the skin. All these are due to a material conception of life. Text 30. Nachashaknom yavastatum brahmativa cha me manaha nimittani cha pushyami vipaditani keshava. I am now unable to stand here any longer. I am forgetting myself, and my mind is reeling. I see only causes of misfortune, O Krishna, killer of the Keshi demon. Purport. Due to his impatience, Arjuna was unable to stay on the battlefield, and he was forgetting himself on account of this weakness of his mind. Excessive attachment for material things puts a man in such a bewildering condition of existence. Bhayam dvitiya bhaneveshya taksyat, Bhagavatam 11.2.37. Such fearfulness and loss of mental equilibrium take place in persons who are too affected by material conditions. Arjuna envisioned only painful reverses on the battlefield. He would not be happy even by gaining victory over the foe. The words nimittani vipaditani are significant. When a man sees only frustration in his expectations, he thinks, why am I here? Everyone is interested in himself and in his own welfare. No one is interested in the Supreme Self. Arjuna is showing ignorance of his real self-interest by Krishna's will. One's real self-interest lies in Vishnu or Krishna. The conditioned soul forgets this and therefore suffers material pains. Arjuna thought that his victory in the battle would only be a cause of lamentation for him. Text 31. Nacha shreho na pasyami hatva svajana mahave nakangse vijayam Krishna nacha rajam sukhanicha. I do not see how any good can come from killing my own kinsmen in this battle, nor can I, my dear Krishna, desire any subsequent victory, kingdom, or happiness. Purport. Without knowing that one's self-interest is in Vishnu or Krishna, conditioned souls are attracted by bodily relationships, hoping to be happy in such situations. In such a blind conception of life, they forget even the causes of material happiness. Arjuna appears to have even forgotten the moral codes for a kshatriya. It is said that two kinds of men, namely the kshatriya who dies directly in front of the battlefield under Krishna's personal orders, and the person in the renounced order of life who is absolutely devoted to spiritual culture, are eligible to enter into the sun globe, which is so powerful and dazzling. Arjuna is reluctant even to kill his enemies, let alone his relatives. He thinks that by killing his kinsmen there would be no happiness in his life, and therefore he is not willing to fight, just as a person who does not feel hunger is not inclined to cook. He has now decided to go into the forest and live a secluded life in frustration, but as a kshatriya, he requires a kingdom for his subsistence, because the kshatriyas cannot engage themselves in any other occupation. But Arjuna has no kingdom. Arjuna's sole opportunity for gaining a kingdom lies in fighting with his cousins and brothers and reclaiming the kingdom inherited from his father, which he does not like to do. Therefore, he considers himself fit to go to the forest to live a secluded life of frustration. Texts 32-35. King Norajina Govinda, King Bhogar Jivatenava, Yesham Arte Kangshitang No, Rajang Bhoga Sukhanicha, Tahime Vastita Yudhe, Pranang Chakvadananicha, Acharya Pitadak Putras, Tataiva Chapitamaham. Matula Shashura Putra Shala Sambandinastata Etanahantum Vichami Gnantopi Madhusudana Apitrai Lokya Rajasya Heto Kingnu Mahikute Nihatya Natarastrana Kapriti Syajanardana. O Govinda, of what avail to us are a kingdom, happiness, or even life itself, when all those for whom we may desire them are now arrayed on this battlefield? O Madhusudana, when teachers, fathers, sons, grandfathers, maternal uncles, fathers-in-law, grandsons, brothers-in-law, and other relatives are ready to give up their lives and properties and are standing before me, why should I wish to kill them, even though they might otherwise kill me? O maintainer of all living entities, I am not prepared to fight with them even in exchange for the three worlds, let alone this earth. What pleasure will we derive from killing the sons of Dhritarashtra? Purport. Arjuna has addressed Lord Krishna as Govinda because Krishna is the object of all pleasures for the cows and the senses. By using this significant word, Arjuna indicates that Krishna should understand what will satisfy Arjuna's senses. But Govinda is not meant for satisfying our senses. If we try to satisfy the senses of Govinda, however, then automatically our own senses are satisfied. Materially, everyone wants to satisfy his senses, and he wants God to be the order supplier for such satisfaction. The Lord will satisfy the senses of the living entities as much as they deserve, but not to the extent that they may covet. But when one takes the opposite way, namely when one tries to satisfy the senses of Govinda, without desiring to satisfy one's own senses, then by the grace of Govinda, all desires of the living entity are satisfied. Arjuna's deep affection for community and family members is exhibited here partly due to his natural compassion for them. He is therefore not prepared to fight. Everyone wants to show his opulence to friends and relatives, but Arjuna fears that all his relatives and friends will be killed on the battlefield and he will be unable to share his opulence after victory. This is a typical calculation of material life. The transcendental life, however, is different. Since a devotee wants to satisfy the desires of the Lord, he can, Lord willing, accept all kinds of opulence for the service of the Lord. And if the Lord is not willing, he should not accept a farthing. Arjuna did not want to kill his relatives, and if there were any need to kill them, he desired that Krishna kill them personally. At this point, he did not know that Krishna had already killed them before their coming onto the battlefield, and that Arjuna was only to become an instrument for Krishna. This fact is disclosed in following chapters. As a natural devotee of the Lord, Arjuna did not like to retaliate against his miscreant cousins and brothers, but it was the Lord's plan that they should all be killed. The devotee of the Lord does not retaliate against the wrongdoer, but the Lord does not tolerate any mischief done to the devotee by the miscreants. The Lord can excuse a person on his own account, but he excuses no one who has done harm to his devotees. Therefore, the Lord was determined to kill the miscreants, although Arjuna wanted to excuse them. Text 36. Papam eva shriyed asman hatvaitana tatahinaha tasman narha vayam huntum datarastran sabandavan sojanam hi katam hatva sukina syama madhava. Sin will overcome us if we slay such aggressors. Therefore, it is not proper for us to kill the sons of Dhritarashtra and our friends. What should we gain, O Krishna, husband of the goddess of fortune? And how could we be happy by killing our own kinsmen? Purport. According to Vedic injunctions, there are six kinds of aggressors. 1. A poison giver. 2. One who sets fire to the house. 3. One who attacks with deadly weapons. 4. One who plunders riches. 5. One who occupies another's land. And 6. One who kidnaps a wife. Such aggressors are at once to be killed, and no sin is incurred by killing such aggressors. Such killing of aggressors is quite befitting any ordinary man, but Arjuna was not an ordinary person. He was saintly by character, and therefore he wanted to deal with them in saintliness. This kind of saintliness, however, is not for a Kshatriya. Although a responsible man in the administration of a state is required to be saintly, he should not be cowardly. For example, Lord Ram was so saintly that people even now are anxious to live in the kingdom of Lord Rama, Ram Raja. But Lord Ram never showed any cowardice. Ravana was an aggressor against Ram because Ravana kidnapped Ram's wife, Sita. But Lord Ram gave him sufficient lessons unparalleled in the history of the world. In Arjuna's case, however, one should consider the special type of aggressors, namely his own grandfather, own teacher, friends, sons, grandsons, etc. Because of them, Arjuna thought that he should not take the severe steps necessary against ordinary aggressors. Besides that, saintly persons are advised to forgive. Such injunctions for saintly persons are more important than any political emergency. Arjuna considered that rather than kill his own kinsmen for political reasons, it would be better to forgive them on grounds of religion and saintly behavior. He did not, therefore, consider such killing profitable simply for the matter of temporary bodily happiness. After all, kingdoms and the pleasures derived therefrom are not permanent, so why should he risk his life and eternal salvation by killing his own kinsmen? Arjuna's addressing of Krishna as Madhava, or the husband of the goddess of fortune, is also significant in this connection. Arjuna wanted to point out to Krishna that, as the husband of the goddess of fortune, he should not induce Arjuna to take up a matter which would ultimately bring about misfortune. Krishna, however, never brings misfortune to anyone, to say nothing of his devotees. Texts 37-38. Yad yapyate na pasyanti lobho pahata chetasa kulaksa yakutam dosham mitra drohe cha patakam katam nagyeyam asmabhi papadasman nivartitum kulaksa yakutam dosham papasyad virjanardana. O Janardana, although these men, their hearts overtaken by greed, see no fault in killing one's family or quarreling with friends, why should we, who can see the crime in destroying a family, engage in these acts of sin? Purport. A Kshatriya is not supposed to refuse to battle or gamble when he is so invited by some rival party. Under such an obligation, Arjuna could not refuse to fight, because he had been challenged by the party of Duryodhana. In this connection, Arjuna considered that the other party might be blind to the effects of such a challenge. Arjuna, however, could see the evil consequences and could not accept the challenge. Obligation is actually binding when the effect is good, but when the effect is otherwise, then no one can be bound. Considering all these pros and cons, Arjuna decided not to fight. Text 39. Kulakshaye panashyanti kuladn dharma sanatana dharme nashte kulam kritsnam adharmo bibhavatyuta. With the destruction of the dynasty, the eternal family tradition is vanquished, and thus the rest of the family becomes involved in irreligion. Purport. In the system of the Varnashram institution, there are many principles of religious traditions to help members of the family grow properly and attain spiritual values. The elder members are responsible for such purifying processes in the family, beginning from birth to death. But on the death of the elder members, such family traditions of purification may stop, and the remaining younger family members may develop irreligious habits and thereby lose their chance for spiritual salvation. Therefore, for no purpose should the elder members of the family be slain. text 40. Adharma bebhavat Krishna padushyanti kulastriya strishu dashtashu varshneya jayate varnasankaraha. When irreligion is prominent in the family, O Krishna, the women of the family become polluted, and from the degradation of womanhood, O descendant of Vrishni, comes unwanted progeny. Purport. Good population in human society is the basic principle for peace, prosperity, and spiritual progress in life. The Varnashram religion's principles were so designed that the good population would prevail in society for the general spiritual progress of state and community. Such population depends on the chastity and faithfulness of its womanhood. As children are very prone to be misled, women are similarly very prone to degradation. Therefore, both children and women require protection by the elder members of the family. By being engaged in various religious practices, women will not be misled into adultery. According to Chanakya Pandit, women are generally not very intelligent and therefore not trustworthy. So the different family traditions of religious activities should always engage them, and thus their chastity and devotion will give birth to a good population eligible for participating in the Varnashram system. On the failure of such Varnashram dharma, naturally the women become free to act and mix with men, and thus adultery is indulged in at the risk of unwanted population. Irresponsible men also provoke adultery in society, and thus unwanted children flood the human race at the risk of war and pestilence. Text 41. Sankaro narakayaiva kulagnanam kulasicha patanti pitado yesham lupta pindo dakakriya. An increase of unwanted population certainly causes hellish life both for the family and for those who destroy the family tradition. The ancestors of such corrupt families fall down because the performances for offering them food and water are entirely stopped. Purport. According to the rules and regulations of fruitive activities, there is a need to offer periodical food and water to the forefathers of the family. This offering is performed by worship of Vishnu, because eating the remnants of food offered to Vishnu can deliver one from all kinds of sinful actions. Sometimes the forefathers may be suffering from various types of sinful reactions, and sometimes some of them cannot even acquire a gross material body and are forced to remain in subtle bodies as ghosts. Thus, when remnants of prasadam food are offered to forefathers by descendants, the forefathers are released from ghostly or other kinds of miserable life. Such help rendered to forefathers is a family tradition, and those who are not in devotional life are required to perform such rituals. One who is engaged in the devotional life is not required to perform such actions. Simply by performing devotional service, one can deliver hundreds and thousands of forefathers from all kinds of misery. It is stated in the Bhagavatam 11.5.41. Devarshi bhutapna hrinam patrinam nakin karo nayam hrini charajan sarvatmana yakshadanam sharanyam kato mukundam padirityakartam. Anyone who has taken shelter of the lotus feet of Mukunda, the giver of liberation, giving up all kinds of obligation, and has taken to the path in all seriousness, owes neither duties nor obligations to the demigods, sages, general living entities, family members, humankind, or forefathers. Such obligations are automatically fulfilled by performance of devotional service to the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Text 42. Doshar eta kulagnanam varnasankadakarakai utsadyante jati dharma kuladharmasta shashvataha. By the evil deeds of those who destroy the family tradition and thus give rise to unwanted children, all kinds of community projects and family welfare activities are devastated. Purport. Community projects for the four orders of human society combined with family welfare activities, as they are set forth by the institution of Sanatana Dharma or Vanashram Dharma, are designed to enable the human being to attain his ultimate salvation. Therefore, the breaking of the Sanatana Dharma tradition by irresponsible leaders of society brings about chaos in that society, and consequently people forget the aim of life, Vishnu. Such leaders are called blind, and persons who follow such leaders are sure to be led into chaos. Text 43. Utsanna kula dharmanam manushyanam janardana narake niyatam vaso bhavati janushushuma. O Krishna, maintainer of the people, I have heard by disciplic succession that those who destroy family traditions dwell always in hell. Purport. Arjuna bases his argument not on his own personal experience, but on what he has heard from the authorities. That is the way of receiving real knowledge. One cannot reach the real point of factual knowledge without being helped by the right person who is already established in that knowledge. There is a system in the Varnashram institution by which before death one has to undergo the process of atonement for his sinful activities. One who is always engaged in sinful activities must utilize the process of atonement called the prayaschitta. Without doing so, one surely will be transferred to hellish planets to undergo miserable lives as the result of sinful activities. Text 44. Aho bhata mahat papam kartum vyavasitavayam yadn raja sukalobhena ahongtung svajanamudnyata. Alas, how strange it is that we are preparing to commit greatly sinful acts. Driven by the desire to enjoy royal happiness, we are intent on killing our own kinsmen. Purport. Driven by selfish motives, one may be inclined to such sinful acts as the killing of one's own brother, father, or mother. There are many such instances in the history of the world. But Arjuna, being a saintly devotee of the Lord, is always conscious of moral principles and therefore takes care to avoid such activities. Text 45. Yadimam apatikaram ashastram shastrapanayaham Dātarāstra rane hunyus dhannek shemataram bhavet. Better for me if the sons of Dhritarāstra, weapons in hand, were to kill me unarmed and unresisting on the battlefield. Purport. It is the custom, according to Kshatriya fighting principles, that an unarmed and unwilling foe should not be attacked. Arjuna, however, decided that even if attacked by the enemy in such an awkward position, he would not fight. He did not consider how much the other party was bent upon fighting. All these symptoms are due to soft-heartedness resulting from his being a great devotee of the Lord. Text 46. Sanjaya huvacha eva muktva arjuna sankhi rato pasta upabhishat visvijja sasharam chapam shoka sang vignamanasaha. Sanjaya said, Arjuna, having thus spoken on the battlefield, cast aside his bow and arrows and sat down on the chariot, his mind overwhelmed with grief. Purport. While observing the situation of his enemy, Arjuna stood up on the chariot, but he was so afflicted with lamentation that he sat down again, setting aside his bow and arrows. Such a kind and soft-hearted person in the devotional service of the Lord is fit to receive self-knowledge. Thus end the Bhaktivedanta purports to the first chapter of the Srimad Bhagavad Gita in the matter of observing the armies on the battlefield of Kurukṣetra.